background, we are celebrating Easter Sunday, where we celebrate and declare that Jesus was raised to life. Amen? Can I hear an amen?
Amen.
Yeah, that He was raised to life and that He is alive today. You know, as Amir mentioned, alongside with that, we're also celebrating 9 baptisms, and those guys are sitting over here. Why don't you give them a warm encouragement? Yeah. And I know many of you guys would have been here for the first time. You've been invited by a friend or family member who's getting baptized today. And we just really want to welcome you. You know, we're a church that believes that no perfect people out here. Yeah. We long, our heart's desire is to welcome people of every race, culture, background. Even if you don't believe in Jesus, even though you might be seeking Him, you know, we want this to be a safe place. There's no kind of arm twisting, you know, there's no kind of Bible bashing. But our earnest heart's desire is to show Jesus in word and deed as best as we can. And we just trust that because Jesus is alive, He will touch lives and change hearts. Amen? And so we just really want to welcome you here. You know, a few months ago, the team began to kind of plan for Easter Sunday, and we decided to celebrate baptism and Easter Sunday together because baptism is grounded in the Easter message. In fact, there's a follower of Jesus, his name is Paul the Apostle, and he writes this piece of scripture to the Christians in Rome, and he describes it this way, in Romans 6, 4-5, and this is what he says, "For we died and were buried with Christ by baptism, and just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glorious power of the Father, now we also may live new lives." Everyone say new lives?
Lives.
New lives. "And since we've been united with Him in His death, we will also be raised to life as He was," right? Let's say that together, raised to life.
Raised
to life. And so that's our theme for today, this morning, that we are raised to life. You know, baptism, here Paul is basically saying, baptism is symbolic of the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And just as, you know, these baptism candidates are going to be lowered into the water, that is symbolic to say that my old way of life has died. My old self, my old ways, my past sins have been forgiven. My future sins have been forgiven. And as they rise out of the water, we are reminded that our new life is made possible because of the resurrection of Jesus. That we have new life in Jesus today. And so today, guys, we're going to be celebrating as you guys take the next step and tell the world that Jesus has brought you from death to life. Amen. You know, for some of us, that might sound a little bit far-fetched. You know, you may not believe that Jesus was raised to life. That can be difficult to believe. But you know what? Nothing demonstrates that Jesus is alive better than stories that have been changed and transformed. Amen? And so that's what we're going to celebrate today. We're going to hear how their lives have moved from death to life, from sadness to joy, from emptiness to fulfillment, from depression to a peace of mind. And that's because Jesus is alive today. And so we want to celebrate Easter, that Jesus has risen, by celebrating their stories. And we're going to invite them up here. We're going to hear some aspects of their story about how their lives were like before they met Jesus. And then we're going to hear what was it, that moment that opened their eyes to the fact that Jesus was real. And at the very end, we're going to celebrate together how Jesus has raised their life from death. Amen. And so many of you guys would have got this baptism booklet. How many of you guys got it? Yeah. So all their testimonies are there in a bit more detail, so you can flick through that in your own time and even take it home and hear their story. So why don't we just invite them up to on stage? Why don't you give them a warm encouragement and welcome, come on, guys, on the stage. Can you give them a warm welcome? This is Mark, our resident Canadian. And this is Shao. Grab a seat, Daniel. David, come on, give me your hand. Samantha, Sandy, Ramonka, Linda, and I just met this guy, Chucks. All right, welcome. Grab a seat, grab a seat. So we got them, the slightly shorter people to sit at the back so you can see them. Wave, yeah? Everyone can see them, yeah? Well, welcome, guys. How are you guys going? Yeah? You're feeling a bit self-conscious? Yeah? All right, just look at me, it's all right. But you know, we decided to bunch them together because it can be a little bit intimidating, so you know, we set them all together. You know, one of the great privileges as a pastor is we get to listen to a little bit of their lives, yeah? I read some of your stories, yeah? Some of you guys I spoke to over the phone and hear a little bit more detail. You know, life can throw so many different things at us, right? It can be sad, it can be joyful, it can be messy, it can be broken but yet restored. So what we want to do is actually take some time right now to hear some of their life stories about what life was like before they met Jesus. So I thought we would begin by introducing Xiao over here, this good-looking young man. Sorry, he's taken. Married a few months ago to Celicia. Celicia here? Yeah, over there? Yeah? Better half. So Xiao, why don't you tell us a little bit about what life was like before you met Christ? And I'm going to give you a mic. Yeah. Thank you.
Hi everyone, my name is Xiao. My life before knowing Jesus was a stable and generally happy life. I had not been raised in a Christian household, nor spent much time contemplating a Christian way of life. But throughout my 20s, I felt a strong internal desire to seek purpose and happiness in my life. I read books and tried to implement their philosophies on detachment, emotional awareness, neurobiology, and the mind-body connection in the hopes that it would lead me down the path of happiness. And for many months, or even a few years, I would feel like I was in a clear state of mind. With purpose, mostly free of negative thoughts, but inevitably, circumstances would change. And that happy state couldn't be sustained. I found my happiness was cyclical. The state was so fragile. It seemed to me that none of these secular books could answer the question of what is my purpose in life, and how could I achieve happiness?
Thank you. So basically you're saying that some of your aspects of your life before you met Christ, you found that there's a struggle to find purpose, meaning, fulfillment?
That's right.
Yeah. So how many of you guys can identify with some of that, yeah? Yeah? And so, just another question. So, what kind of questions did that leave you with, you know, being in that season of life?
I wanted more purpose in life. I wanted something. It seemed like there was a void there. You know, something was still missing.
Yeah. Okay. So what we want to do is hear some of their stories. But everyone of us have our own story, yeah, right? And we might have different journeys through it. But you know what? Oftentimes we can relate to the same questions. Yeah. And oftentimes life can leave us with different sorts of questions. And so that's kind of what we want to draw out. So why don't we go to Sam? If you can pass the mic over there. This is Samantha. Everyone say hi, Sam.
Hi, Sam.
Yeah. Okay. Now, Sam, what are you doing right now? You're studying? Yeah? Yep, and you can speak into it. It's okay.
Hi.
Hi. She's actually going to be baptized by her father today. I think that's a great privilege. Yeah. So tell us a little bit, you were raised in this church, or you grew up in this church? Or?
Yeah, so I grew up in this church, so because my parents are Christian, I grew up in a Christian church. Mature kids church and Sunday school, youth group and all that. And so we learned about stories from the Bible, and so I knew God loved me, God was always there, but it was just something I sort of knew but never really felt. And a few years ago, I went through a lot of struggle. I felt really lonely, a lot of sadness. Left me asking, was God even there for me? Did he love me? Is he even real? And I guess I found him in the same year. Thinking about lyrics of some worship songs at church, and I really felt his love. It felt really uplifting.
So even though you kind of grew up in this kind of Christian community environment, you still had a lot of those kind of questions, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So did you feel alone in that journey, or did you feel that?
Yeah, very alone, because I felt like no one really fully understood what I was going through.
Yeah.
So, yeah. But then God understands me. He's always there. Jesus has gone through everything as well, so he fully understands what I'm going through.
Yeah. So if you can kind of repeat it, if you were to describe some of the questions that you had in that season of life, what would that be?
If God was real, if he loved me,
yeah. Yeah, right. How many of us can relate to some of those questions? Yeah. I know for myself, you know, even though you can go through sickness and everything else, you do ask those questions. It's not like, you know, it's abstain from doubt, but those questions drive us back to discover God in a fresh new way. So why don't we hear from Daniel? This is Daniel Miguel. So why don't you tell us a little bit about what life was like before you met Christ?
Hello, everyone. Good morning, church. From a young age, I'd always believed in God. When I was a young teenager, I started drinking alcohol and using drugs, which led me to make many incorrect life choices, such as constant drink and drug driving, and generally getting into trouble with the law. As a result of my unacceptable behavior, I nearly went to jail several times, but I was lucky enough that I was given chances to remain in the community. Back in 2009, I had a breakdown, and I was very scared, so I prayed to God and asked Him, what should I do? He said to me, go to your father. So I did that. My father and sister organized for me to go to hospital for treatment. I was diagnosed with depression, schizophrenia, and major anxiety. After medical treatment for these conditions, I decided enough was enough, and I went to rehab for 16 weeks so I could stop substance addiction and clean up all the loose ends in my life. When I cleared all outstanding legal matters and considered all consolidated all my fines into community work. For the next 3 years, my life was very hard, learning how to deal with my mental health issues and side effects of my medication. My family and God gave me so much support through all this time, and still do.
Is your father here?
Yes, my father and sister
Dad,
are sitting
here. I can't imagine what that journey would be like. I only met Daniel, you know, a few weeks ago and just having a conversation with him. And sometimes you look at people on the outside, you can't tell, can you? You can't tell that people have been through that journey. And, you know, we've all been through some of those different stories and different journeys. So if you could describe any questions, what kind of questions did life leave you with?
I was wondering if I was ever going to get better, if I'd ever feel normal again, if the empty void inside me could be fulfilled. Throughout that time, I was scared and very upset, and I was wondering if I could overcome that and become a happy person again.
Yeah. Now, how many of you guys here can relate to that? Yeah, put up your hand. Yeah. I wish I could go into the depths of some of their stories, but out of, you know, respect, and we really need to preserve some of the confidentiality. But thank you for sharing that.
Yeah. Thank you.
Now, what I want us to do right now, as you're listening to that story, you know, life can be messy, and life can take us from different journeys. But what life can do is can leave us with questions. Yeah, why am I here? What is it that's actually going to make me happy? Am I going to ever change? Is there going to be hope out of this? Does anyone actually notice and care about me? And so what I want us to do is just take, you know, 30 seconds to 1 minute right now. Close your eyes. Everyone close your eyes. And Sarah plays in the background. What I want to do is just to take 1 minute just to pause and to reflect on your life. Where is life for you right now? And what kind of questions do you have? Does somebody sharing resonate in your heart? I want you to take some time right now to take a minute just to reflect on that before the Lord. That Jesus is risen and alive today. And even though He may not be physically present, but He oftentimes, we experience Him through the Word of God, we experience Him through the Christian community, we can experience Him through circumstances and situations. And when we do, it feels like it's more than just a religious moment. It's a moment where you feel like, hey, Jesus is here. He sees, He knows, He hears everything, and He's coming to me. And it's weird, you know, you can sit in church, you can have a Christian friend who's been there with you by your side for so long. But you can hear the word Jesus being bantered around so many times, but oftentimes there comes a moment, yeah. A moment in our life where we experience this moment where, it's like a divine moment, a moment where our eyes were finally open to Jesus, yeah. And so what I want to do is hear from some of you guys, what were some of those moments for you, yeah. The moment where your eyes was open to Jesus, and He began to invade, you know, your life. And so what I thought would be good is maybe we'll hear from David. David, I believe you came from a Buddhist background. And his family owns one of the best best wonton noodle store in Springville. Can I tell your mom I said that?
Yeah, wonton.
Yeah? So I get free wontons. I'm teasing. But David, you know, share with us the moment when your eyes was open to Jesus.
During high school, our school organized a program every Friday at lunchtime. So people from church would come up, play messy games, and outside would be breakdance. And every Friday I'd just come there and just go to the breakdance side. So over time, meeting the guys, it was Duke, Tim, Adrian, and Brian, and they were teaching the breakdance. So over time I got to know them, and eventually they asked me to come to youth. So after Friday, there was youth, I think it was 4 p.m. or later. So then I started going to youth, and I was meeting people that were quite nice and welcoming. From going to youth, I started to see what love was. The fact that people are welcoming and nice, brings warmth into your heart, kind of thing. But over a period of time, I started to fall away. I didn't go so much, but over a couple of years I came back and then accepted Christ. I know life isn't perfect. I still have my ups and downs, but every time there's a down moment, I know when to seek God.
Thank you. So you would describe it that God would abuse people, kind of thing, to you?
That's all.
Yeah. Is age here? Yeah, over there? Hey, age. I remember when David first started coming to youth as well. Back then, we used to do stuff in Wellington, secondary, and you know, the Christian life's not perfect. There's a lot of ups and downs, and like you shared, you know, the freedom within community, we experience Jesus in that, the good and the bad, but we can experience, you can come back again, you know, and we experience Christ in that way. So thank you, Dave. So why don't we hear from Dimalka? Yeah, you can hand the mic over to Dimalka. So Dimalka, share with us, you know, I believe you came up from a non-Christian background as well. Yeah, is that right?
Buddhist background.
Okay, Buddhist background as well. So why don't you tell us a little bit about the moment when your eyes was open to Jesus?
It was seeking for answers, lot of situations and things. And then one day I said, there should be a solution, there should be an answer for my questions. And then I start coming to church without knowing anybody. And that's, I knew that that was the place I have to be. And straight away I decided to get baptized because I found everything what I need and I was asking for when I came to church.
How did you know that the Christian community church was the place that you were meant to be?
I was with friends who were Christians and then I started going with them. And then one day I just thought I'm going to come to this church because I just around this area. I was living around this area.
And how did you encounter God in the midst of that?
It is a very happy new person. And loneliness has gone. And I have a friend. I worship every day. And my life has changed. And very happy.
So how did that happen? Was it something you did or how did that change happen?
Through prayers and listening to all the things, reading the Bible, guidance from the church, all the answers were there.
So it's a bit of a gradual change, but you feel that you found your answers here.
Exactly.
In Christ. Thank you. Everyone give them a hand. Now I'm going to go to this Canadian here, on the far, your far left. He's the only Canadian Asian that I know. I believe you struggle with a bit of depression as well during your life before Christ. So why don't you share a little bit about some of those moments when your eyes were open to the reality of Jesus?
As she shared, I have suffered through a few years of depression. I think about 10 years if I were to put a number on it. So eventually push came to shove, and I failed a bunch of university classes and had to be held back a year. And I really didn't feel like there was anyone there ever with me. I always felt alone, and you know, being in a new city in Melbourne, away from my family, I always felt like there was no one who understood me. I didn't have anyone supporting me, and I always felt like at the end of the day, there was nothing for me. And at the 2014 Emerge Camp, which
so Emerge is our tertiary ministry.
Yeah, go to you.
That's true.
So the 2014 Emerge Camp, what happened was the depression hit an all-time low, and I realized that, you know, there's nothing left for me in this world. And as soon as I got home, I was going to go home and plan out and commit suicide myself. And I honestly thought in my heart that that was the only answer, and there was nothing left for me in this world. And right when I thought that was it, Andy Choi, who's here today, he was my cell group, life group leader at the time, and he came over to me and said, "Hey Mark, could we just pray for you for a moment?" And I said, "Sure, why not? There's no harm, you know, whatever. Just go home later and finish it myself." And as he prayed for me, I had some people that I had no idea who they were, what they even did in the church at any sort of time in my life. And some of those people are Stuart, he's on the Connect team in the back there, and there's another guy named Josh or something. Still don't know who he is.
Do you know who you are, Josh?
I don't even know if he's here. But they came over me and they prayed over me, and the really amazing thing is the theme of that camp was overflow, and many speakers spoke on the sermon of the woman at the well who came to the well and was ostracized by everyone around her, and she always felt truly alone, and yet Jesus came to her and spoke words of life into her life, spoke things that no one else could possibly have known but Jesus. And the same thing happened to me at that camp. And people like Stu, people like Andy, you know, some people I know, some people who I didn't know, they came to me and they spoke words of life into me. They spoke words that, you know, no one else knew what I was suffering through, and yet those people came to me and prayed over me those exact same words what I was feeling. And to me, that just showed me, maybe there is someone, something out there that truly loves and cares for me, and, you know, appreciates that I have life, and that life has a greater purpose than just death at the end.
Did you want to share some more? No, that was it. What I meant was whether you were interrupted by the applause, but
I'm good.
There anything else you wanted to share?
I'm good.
You're good. Okay. No. So basically, you're saying that the fact that, you know, people who didn't really know you began to pray and speak words about your life that there's no way they would know about, that was like a divine supernatural moment for you. Yeah. How many of you guys have experienced that?
Yeah.
Well, why don't we hear from Linda?
Yeah.
Linda's over here. How long ago did you come to our church?
I started going to church last Easter, last year. And that was because I was invited to church by a friend, Winnie, from uni, that I happened to bump into on a night out with friends.
Yeah.
And I was agnostic at the time. I was going through some personal hardships at the time, so I was like, okay, why not? Because she invited me to come meet up over here. And church, I came from a non-Christian household, and I'm surrounded by non-Christian friends, so I didn't know what church was like. And it's once I stepped inside here, it was totally mind-blowing, because it's totally new and different experience, and very, very different from what I see on The Simpsons.
Praise God.
And quite different to Whoopi Goldberg in Sister Act as well. But church instead was a very accepting, very warm and supportive environment, which I really liked. So I kept going to church, and then eventually I got into life group. really enjoyed as well. And I came to understand that it's truly that support and that fellowship with that we have with our brothers and sisters in Christ that keeps us going through our faith. So that was really important to me. And I was also touched when Pastor Kenny said that everyone, whether they're black or white or yellow or blue, regardless of race, regardless of gender, regardless of status, can come to church and come harmoniously and rejoice together. I was also touched when Pastor Dan Lian, who did a sermon on Easter, he said that the same power that God used to resurrect Jesus back to life is the same power that he is using in each and every one of our lives.
Amen.
And I was also touched when singing along to the hymns that each line on the screen reflected how great and how powerful that God and Jesus are.
Fantastic. Very good. So any blue people here, we welcome you. but now, if you, to put you a little bit on the spot here, but if you were to describe what you love about Jesus, what would you say?
He's always there for you. And he's always there to love you and to help you when you really need him.
Okay. Thank you. So one of the things that we wanted to share out of that was that, you know what, we can all go through life stories, many of us would have similar experiences, but you have those moments, yeah, and they are divine moments where your eyes are just open to the reality of Jesus being alive. And you know what, the reason why I wanted to hear you, for you to hear this story is that behind their story is actually the greater story. And their testimonies is basically one big finger pointing to the cross of Jesus, amen? I mean, we may not be able to put words to it to say, you know, Jesus died for us, but we know it in our lives, in our hearts, enough to be able to say, I used to live this way, but now I want to live this way. Right? Enough for people to make that decision of surrender and conviction at our best to try and follow and change our whole way of life to now, today, wanting to publicly declare, I want to follow him. Yeah. You and I know no kind of arm twisting and convincing argument can ever make you do that. It is a conviction of the heart. And so what we want to do is that to highlight now is that their story is one big finger pointing to the greater story, and that is the story of Jesus. And so as Linda shared, there was a hymn, and we're going to invite Amy Grace up here. There was a hymn that can minister to us, because the lyrics of the song is birthed out of the heart of the composer. So it's an overflow of their love for God and for Jesus. And she's going to minister to us, Amy, a very familiar hymn, okay? And so what I want you to do is just reflect on some of those words. But as they do, guys, what I want you to do is this, okay? I'm going to give you guys each a sheet of paper. And I want to get you to do something as a sign of what Jesus has done for you, okay? So what I want you to do is to grab one sheet of paper. Get them to do is actually on that one sheet of paper to describe the one word, in one word, what their life was like before Christ and what Jesus took on the cross for. And what they're going to do is write one word as that song is being played. And they're going to show it to you guys, and then they come up here and then they're basically going to nail it to the cross. Okay? Amy. Before we drink together, you know, this is what the scripture says in Romans 6:4-5. For we died and we were buried with Christ by baptism. And just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glorious power of the Father, the outcome of that is that now we also may live new lives. And since we have been united with him in his death, and this is the hope, that we will also be raised to life as he was. In my heartbeat for this Sunday was to go, how do we share what Christ has done in such a meaningful way that it makes sense for us? That moves beyond the words to be able to understand the life change that it brings to people. And here the cross is a picture of two things. It is a picture, number one, of the brokenness of life. And as you've heard the stories, and as you've been reflecting on your own life, there is brokenness of life. There is confusion, there's emptiness, there's depression, there's loneliness, there's hopelessness, stress, insecurity. And I don't know what your list might be, but the Lord took that upon himself. And our goal is not to come to God so that we can reap all these benefits of a changed life, of a better life. But the promise is this: if the NASB version puts this, if we have been united with him, our goal is to be united back into this relationship with God. And out of that overflow of that relationship, there is life. Amen. And then when we drink the cup, what we are saying is that we are declaring that we have moved from death to life. Amen. We have moved from insecurity to acceptance. We have moved from stress to peace of mind. We have moved from anxiety to a sense that God is in control of all things. We have moved from confusion to a sense of certain hope in the midst of uncertainty. We have moved from hopelessness to a place of certain hope. We have moved from emptiness to
into a place of fulfillment. We have moved from depression into a place of understanding that God is in charge of all things and there is always hope. And we have moved from loneliness to the sense that God is a God who will be with us throughout all the ages as the shepherd through the valley and the highs and the lows. Amen? That is the declaration that we're going to make as we drink together, that Christ, as we have been united with Him, our lives have been raised to life. Amen? So let's drink together and I'll pray. Lord God, we just want to thank You for the sacrifice of Your Son. We thank You as we're united with You, Lord, that out of the overflow of our relationship with You, we don't deserve it, but Lord God, there is the benefit as we trust, as we have faith, as we surrender our life. We no longer want to live our life without You. We want to live our lives with You, under Your leadership, under Your rule. And as we lay down our life, we find that we pick it up again. And Lord God, we just praise You for the way Your hand has been upon these guys, and also for Your hand upon my life and upon the lives of people here. And Lord God, we thank You that that invitation extends to everyone else here who do not know You. And so Lord God, we just want to give You praise in the name of Jesus. And everyone said, courage for us as Christians, right? To go with your story, right? And sometimes it's a long journey, but you know what? It is the work of God. You don't pull and twist people's hands. Just let God live your life before God and share your story. Number two is for those of us who may not be believing in Jesus, who might be a little bit from a distance. I want to encourage you, right? With no arm twisting or in any way, shape, or form. But for you to be able to reflect back on some of the moments that you might have had in your life. For some of you, you might have thought, you know what, this is a little bit more of a coincidence, you know, we're very closed off to it. We've had our friend tell us about Christ, but we're just, I don't want to have anything to do with it. But my prayer for you is for you to just be open. Open your heart and just go, maybe there is something here. Because if it's real, it will be real, yeah? God will show Himself. But open your heart, take that one step towards that journey, and just open your heart and say, God, I pray that You will reveal. And perhaps some of these moments in my life wasn't just coincidence. It wasn't just coincidence that Linda was walking and catching up with Winnie, and then all of a sudden Winnie would invite her here, and then she would have a divine moment here. Amen? You know, for some of us, we might be a little bit more, to pray. You know, you had those moments, you're open to it, but pray and say, God, reveal more and more of Yourself to me. I want to be hungry, show Yourself. In the same way that You've shown Yourself to them, show Yourself to me, right? Pray that prayer in your heart. But for some of us here, you know what? You might have had a whole bunch of experiences. But what will take you from the journey from death to life is a decision of faith. It's a decision where you will say, you know what? I'm just going to trust. I'm going to surrender my life and no longer live my life without God. But I'm going to willingly trust and surrender my life and come under His leadership and follow Him. I don't have all the answers, but I believe that's the step of faith. And if that's you, we want to encourage you, just come up to the front right here. You can speak to one of us over here on my left. We want to be able to speak to you and share a little bit about who Christ is. And if that's you, you want to take that journey of faith, then we want to embrace you and welcome you. Amen?